name is Alexandria Jackson. I'm a first-term student here at Lane Community College, so I like it here a lot. I don't have a major planned quite yet. I'm just exploring and testing the waters to see what I want out of my education right now. So hopefully it'll take me somewhere great. And I'm part of the BSU here, and it's a great program. It's an extreme honor and privilege to be welcoming Dr. Austin here with us today. Dr. Curtis Austin is a current associate professor at the University of Oregon in the Department of History. He received his PhD from Mississippi State in 1998. He previously taught at the Ohio State University, where he directed the Young Scholars Program and taught civil rights movement history in the Department of African American and African Studies. Dr. Austin also served as the department's director of undergraduate studies. Before moving to Ohio, he taught African American history at the University of Southern Mississippi and served as director of the Center for Oral History and Cultural Heritage from 2001 to 2006. In 2007, Dr. Austin became the founding director of the University of Southern Mississippi Center for Black Studies. His first book, Up Against the Wall, Violence in the Making and Unmaking of the Black Panther Party, chronicled the national history of the Black Panther Party and received wide acclaim from students, lay people, activists, and scholars in the fields of American history and African American studies. In 2007, Up Against the Wall received critical acclaim from the Choice Library Journal honored it with its Outstanding Academic Title Award. Professor Austin has also published book chapters, encyclopedia and journal articles, and web-based pieces on the history of blacks in America. Austin's current research projects include a work entitled Dare to Struggle, which explains and analyzes the history of the Black Power Movement. This work is currently under contract with Roman and Littlefield Press. He is also completing work on a project that chronicles the history of the San Francisco Eight, a group of former members of the Black Panther Party who in 2011 successfully fought to have the California court system drop charges of homicide stemming from the 1971 death of a San Francisco police officer. Now, without further ado, it is my distinct honor to welcome Dr. Austin to the stage.
Thank you all for coming out tonight. And I am looking forward to having some good dialogue. Of course, it won't start out with a dialogue. It'll be a monologue. And hopefully I won't bore you to sleep as a result of my monologue. But I'd like to kind of set the mood for my talk tonight by playing you a 3-minute song. And the song is really self-explanatory, so you want to listen closely because it goes hand in hand with what I'll be saying over the next hour, however much time I get before somebody gets the cane and yanks me. So check this out.
You have the emergence in human society of this thing that's called the state. What is the state? The state is this organized bureaucracy. It is the police department. It is the army, the navy. It is the prison system, the courts, and what have you. This is the state. It is a repressive organization. But the state, and well, you know, you've got to have the police, because if there were no police, look at what you'd be doing to yourselves. You'd be killing each other if there were no police. But the reality is, the police become necessary in human society.
You know how we think. Organize the hood under our chain banners. Red, black, and green instead of gang bandanas. FBI spying on us through the radio antennas. And I'm hitting cameras in the streetlight watching society. With no respect for the people's right to privacy. I take a slug for the cause like Huey P. While all you fake niggas try to copy Master P. I wanna be free to live, able to have what I need to live. Bring the power back to the street where the people live. We sick of working for crumbs and filling up the prisons. Dying over money and relying on religion for help. We do for self like ants in a colony. Organize the wealth into a socialist economy. A way of life based off the common needs. And all my comrades is ready, we just spreading the seed.
Live a third of his life in a jail cell. Cause the world is controlled by the white male. And the people don't never get justice. And the
women don't never get respected, and the problems don't never get solved, and the jobs don't never pay enough, so the rent always be late. Can you relate?
No more bondage, no more political monsters, no more secret space launches. Government departments started it in the projects, material objects, thousands up in the closets. Could have been invested in the future for my comrades. Battle contacts, primitive weapons out in combat. Many never come back, pretty niggas be running with gas. Rather get shot in they back than fire back. We tired of that, corporations hiring blacks, denying the facts, exploiting us all over the map. That's why I write the shit I write in my raps. It's documented, I meant it. Every day of the week, I live in it, breathe in it. It's more than just fucking believing it. I'm holding in ones, rolling up my sleeves and shit. It's CeeLo for push-ups now, many headed for one conclusion. Niggas ain't ready for revolution.
The average black male, live a third of his life in a jail cell. Cause the world is controlled by the white male. And the people don't never get justice. And the women don't never get respected. And the problems don't never get solved. And the jobs don't never pay enough, so the rent always be late. Can you relate? We living in a police state.
So that, ladies and gentlemen, is the way I want to set the stage tonight for our talk. If you think about the words in the song, if you could get past the beat, for those of you who didn't like that slamming beat, what you're gonna see is that everything I'm talking about tonight is sort of encapsulated by the words of that song. And this song was written 30 years after the history I'll be discussing. And I hope that in the question and answer session, we can get into not just 60s era stuff, but contemporary stuff as well. So as you can see, tonight I'm going to be talking about the Black Panther Party and Revolution in America. The title, A Different Kind of Cat, comes from a 60s phrase, for those of you who lived through that period. In addition to people saying to each other, hey, what's up, brother? What's up, sister? People often would refer to each other as cats. And of course, part of what I'll be discussing is also the Black Panther Party. That's a feline, that's a cat. But tonight, we're gonna be talking about different kinds of cats, all right? So stay with me if you will. I mentioned the contemporary stuff. You know from having watched the news that Black Lives Matter emerged as a result of police killing black people. Police were killing black people in the 60s. They were killing black people in the 30s. They were killing black people in the 1890s. They were killing black people during enslavement, during the Middle Passage, and during the time when they were snatched out of their huts and villages and brought to the beach to be put on the ships. And so I think the sign on the right says it all. Like, that's the solution to this particular problem. It's not complicated. You don't have to go to a big fancy university to figure it out. You just gotta stop doing that if you want things to get better and you don't want certain things to happen. Of course, we know these images because CNN and MSNBC and social media helped us to learn about the lives of people like Trayvon and Rekia Boyd and Sandra Bland and Mike Brown. And I can spend literally the next 2 days just talking about people the police have killed in our community, unarmed and for absolutely no reason. And I could probably spend more than 2 days because, and many of you probably know that there are two to three black people a week are killed by police officers in this country. That is the same amount of people that were lynched in this country from 1890 to 1950, the exact same amount. So I just want you to get with me and understand where I'm going to be coming from so you can see what black people were up against. These are just some basic images from that particular period. You see people having been lynched. That picture in the right top right corner is a picture of Tulsa, Oklahoma, the Greenwood community. You've probably heard of Black Wall Street. These are all images where people were essentially living while black. They didn't do anything to deserve their murders. The people in Greenwood, Oklahoma didn't do anything to deserve to have their town burnt to the ground. Well, they actually did do something. They succeeded. And if you have the time, summer is coming up, it's great beach reading. If you pick up a book by Carol Anderson called White Rage, she kind of takes you through African-American history and showing you step by step how literally every time African-Americans, from the first day after the Civil War to like yesterday, every time they succeed, you get people trying to push them back. And it's not the Aryan Nation. It's not the Ku Klux Klan. It's local, state, and federal governments trying to push them back. And there's still, after all of this, there's still no anti-lynching law in the United States. I'm pretty sure you don't believe that. And for those of you who think that these are just bad apples, you know, these are all the racist, the bad people in the community, actually, lynching of black people was a community event. And this is just one example of people in the community coming out to see the killing of a black person. Trains would give discounts on their tickets. There would be food served. People would raise money from that food. And as you see, the first word on this slide says postcard. So you and I send pictures of our families and our kids around New Year's or Christmas. Say, hey, Happy New Year, Merry Christmas. Look at my little baby, look at me, you know. During this particular period, people sent postcards of black people being murdered around Christmas and New Year's. And this is just one of many. If you're interested in more of that, there's a website called Without Sanctuary that you could check out, and it'll show you as much of that as you like. I have no doubt that you're familiar with this 15-year-old boy who died in my home state in Mississippi in 1955. Of course, he died after being murdered by some residents of Mississippi, J.W. Milam and Roy Bryant, who heard through the grapevine that he had whistled at a white woman. He had not. And again, living while black. They abducted him from his great uncle's house, Mose Ray, beat him unmercifully, chopped him up with an axe, shot him through the penis and the head, tied his body up with a cotton gin fan and dumped it into the Tallahatchie River. And they didn't tie the knot because the body came up 3 days later. A white fisherman found it, called the sheriff. The sheriff, everybody knew who did that. The word had been going around town. Everybody knew who did it. And so the sheriff arrested him. You know the rest of the story. They went to court, got acquitted. 6 months later, they tell Look magazine, yeah, we did it, and here's how we did it. And nothing ever happened to him. Why? Because of something in this country called double jeopardy. Can't be tried twice for the same crime. So again, living while black. You don't know this guy. I'm actually writing a book on a guy named Clyde Kennard. He was the first person to try to desegregate my undergraduate alma mater, the University of Southern Mississippi. In 1955, he returned from the Korean War, used his GI Bill to register for classes at the University of Chicago, was a straight-A student for 3 years until his father in Mississippi died. He had bought his mother and father land while he was in the military, winning all kinds of awards and whatnot, Medal of Valor, Purple Heart, that kind of thing. And so he left the University of Chicago to go back to Mississippi to help his mother take care of the farm. And rather than going back to Chicago for school after he got the farm together, he decided to go to school 5 miles down the road. After all, it's 1957, Brown versus Board is 2 years old. Supreme Court says you can go to school anywhere you want. And his GI Bill rights said that he could go to school anywhere he wanted. And as a matter of fact, when he applied, the University of Southern Mississippi admitted him, accepted him. Of course, it's 1957, so he's applying on paper. And he shows up on campus and they go, oh, you're black. We didn't realize that. And they decided that, no, you can't actually do that. So they asked him to withdraw his application. He refused to. This story, I've taught like a 10-week class on this particular story, so I could go on forever about this, and I won't. But he refused to withdraw his application, and they tried all kinds of stuff, including planting liquor in his car. Mississippi was a dry state at the time. That didn't stick. They tried to cut his brake line so that he would have a wreck in his car. That didn't work. They finally stole chicken feed from a local co-op and placed that chicken feed on his farm. Remember I told you he had a farm? Well, they found the chicken feed and arrested him for burglary of the co-op and theft of the chicken feed. An all-white jury convicted him in about 10 minutes, and he was sentenced to 7 years hard labor in Parchment Penitentiary. 3 years into that sentence, he was dead. Just because he wanted to go to school. Straight A student. You know, what was he doing? There are other familiar stories. You've heard of the four little girls. They were killed in Alabama, in Birmingham, 1963, 16th Street Baptist Church. All they were doing was changing clothes from having been in Sunday school, getting ready to go to church. The Klan bombed that church. It was more than 30 years before that crime was solved, despite the fact that an FBI agent was a part of the crime. Okay, it's not like they didn't know. And if you think it's just black people, it's anybody who wants to help black people. One woman by the name of Viola Lauzzo, a Detroit school teacher who had joined the NAACP, came down to the Selma to Montgomery march, decided she would help out with that march. The march is over. She's transporting people from Montgomery back to Selma. The Klan shoots through her car window, kills her. There's also an FBI agent in that vehicle. Think she got justice? People say Malcolm X is violent. I always tell my students, you know, find me one violent act Malcolm X perpetrated, and I'll give you an A. Been teaching for 23 years. Nobody's taken me up on that yet. So you can say or do anything. You cannot say or do anything. You're still going to wind up in a bad, bad situation. So this is all going on around the time that we call the Civil Rights Movement. But that movement starts to morph and shift into a different kind of movement called the Black Power Movement. You've certainly heard of Stokely Carmichael, who articulated Black Power. And this takes place in June of 1966 on something called the Meredith March Against Fear. James Meredith had decided that the Voting Rights Act said that people could vote. Black people in Mississippi were still afraid to vote. He was going to walk from Memphis, which abuts the Mississippi state line, to Jackson to show black people that you don't have to be afraid. Watch me just take this march and talk about voting. Well, the second day of the march, he got shot. And people like Martin Luther King and Stokely Carmichael took up the march, and that's the march on which the Black Power slogan was made popular. There were lots of newspaper reporters, lots of TV reporters in the crowd this night. And just imagine, it might be hard to do, but just imagine a bunch of black people in a crowd where Stokely Carmichael's going, what do you want? And the crowd's going, Black Power. What do you want? Black Power, when do you want it? Now. And you know, it's 300 black people and 10 white people. You gotta be pretty on edge, right? Well, we read the papers the next day, the New York Times, we see CBS the next day, and now black people are out to kill white people because they want some black power. It had nothing to do with that. What it did have to do was the county he was in, LaFleur County, there in Greenwood, Mississippi, is 80% black. He's saying, just go vote. You'll have some power. But they turned that into a violent thing. And from there, we get the organization that we're going to be focusing most of our time on this evening, and that's the Black Panther Party. That is June of 1966. In October of 1966, Huey Newton and Bobby Seale run into one of their homeboys who's been down in Alabama working with the Lowndes County Freedom Organization. And the Lowndes County Freedom Organization was one of these organizations. Lowndes County is in Alabama. It had 90% black population. And they decided that they were going to start their own political party. Well, the law in Alabama said that because so many people were illiterate, you had to have a symbol. So the Democratic Party's symbol was a white rooster. And they decided they need to come up with something that would defeat the white rooster. And so they came up with that image, a Black Panther. That's where the Black Panther came from. Well, they had a cousin in Oakland that was visiting. He took some flyers back to Oakland. Bobby Seale and Huey Newton had already been talking about doing something. Mark Comfort, the guy I'm referring to, showed them these flyers. And they was like, oh, yeah, that's who we are. And so they stole the name and the image. And I think that's funny because they've been in court now about three times in the last 10 years trying to sue the new Black Panther Party for using their name. And it always comes down to, actually, you don't own that. You know, you can't sue them because it's actually not yours. But in any case, the Black Panther Party comes on the scene in October of 1966 because of this brutality that I tried to set the backdrop for you with. It's October. So in the first 10 months of 1966, there are 10 murders of black people in the San Francisco Bay Area. 10 murders. So we're used to these days, we don't see them, but you know, maybe get one a year, two a year. Imagine 10 murders, all justifiable homicide. The youngest murdered individual, 11. The oldest, 82. All justifiable. And so they decided they needed to do something about this violence. And that's what they decided to do. They were going to defend and protect the black community. So they start this organization. They look at what the Lowndes County Freedom Organization was doing and decide they're going to be a political party, but a different kind of political party. And I just like to say, at this particular point, the Panthers aren't all that radical. They've been made out to be extremely radical, but if you just take a really quick look at their 10-point platform and program, which is their guiding document, the philosophy that guided them, tell me what's so radical about wanting to be free, number one. That makes you radical? I mean, you'd be all radicals and in jail. I'm imagining you want to be free. What's so radical, number two, if you want a job, you know? What's wrong with having a good job? Is that radical? What about not wanting to be exploited? What if I told you when you leave, you got to give me $1,000? You wouldn't want to do that, right? What if I made you do that? And you might have a different kind of reaction, right? That is not a radical thing, wanting to not be exploited. What is radical about wanting decent housing? What's radical about wanting an adequate education? Can you tell me? It's a real question. It's not rhetorical. Is there something radical about that? Black men exempt from military service. Oh, well, why? I mean, okay, well, let's talk about all the things that were happening up to this point. You're going to join the military and go at this point to Vietnam, defend the Vietnamese and save their country for democracy. But if you're Clyde Kinnard, there ain't that much democracy to be saving for people, right? Because you're not getting any in Jackson, Mississippi. You're certainly not getting any in Boston with the busing issue. So they asked themselves, why would we go 10,000 miles around the world to fight for an entity that's been killing us, that's been denying us civil liberties and human rights for time immemorial? I don't think that's a radical thing. And maybe in the Q&A, you can tell me why that's radical. Okay, so number eight, you want all black men in jails and prisons free. All right, not all of them, you know, but most of them, because at this point, people were being tried by all white juries who didn't understand the average person in the black community. Just imagine if white people got tried by all black people. right? How many convictions? What's the conviction rate you think is going to be? It's going to be 100% conviction rate because of this crazy thing they've got us in, right? Same thing here. Most of the time, the jails are being filled up with black and brown people. That didn't just start happening in the 1980s. That's been going on since they decided that slavery was no longer legal. It started shortly after that. I won't beat this horse to death, but I'm really trying to say that because the Panthers dress a particular way, you know, these black uniforms, or black berets, or black boots, they carried weapons, which was completely lawful. I mean, for those of you who've been in Oregon a long time, what if somebody tried to tell you you can't carry your weapon, right? They'd have some trouble, wouldn't they? Well, in California, it was the same thing. You know, there was nothing illegal about carrying weapons. And so what they would do is watch the police. And how would they watch the police? They would follow them throughout their communities. They see a police car show up, they get in their cars, drive behind them until they stop somebody. They stop somebody. The law said you needed to be standing 25 feet away from a police officer carrying out his or her duties. They would stand 100 feet away and yell over, "Hey, brother, hey, sister, we're the Black Panther Party. We're just here to make sure that you don't get brutalized or beaten. And if you happen to get taken to jail, we'll come and bail you out." This goes on day in and day out in the Oakland black community. And the police don't like it, as you can imagine, right? And they, of course, yell at the Black Panthers, "Who do you think you are? You need to get out of here." But of course, nothing ever happens. And why doesn't anything happen? Because people are armed. They're not pointing their guns at anybody. They're just saying, "We're the Black Panther Party. We're here to make sure that nothing happens to you." Remember I told you 10 people died in the 10 months before the party was founded? Well, the party's founded in October 1967. From October 67 to November 67, you want to know how many people died? Yep, zero. You can't hear her, but she said it. No shootouts, no confrontations, no, zero. What does that say about the police? And they got tired of killing black people? Yeah. What's that?
They need to be checked.
I think they felt checked. And you can see in this particular image, Bobby Seale and Bobby Hutton, actually the first member to join the party. Bobby Hutton was 15 when he joined the party. And by the way, the average member of the Black Panther Party was 19. So quite young. They're standing outside of the jail here where they have followed somebody down and they're bailing them out. And they got lots of recruits this way. And sometimes when they bail people out, they went back and told their friends and families. Those people joined the Black Panther Party. Well, eventually, this thing is going to come to a head. The cops are so upset about this that they go to their local assembly person, Don Mulford, and say, "You got to do something about these guys. You know, these black people following us with guns." Of course, they probably didn't say black people, right? You know. But you got to do something about them. And of course, Mulford's like, "I got you. I'm going to go do that." And he goes right up to Sacramento, starts to write this bill, and all of a sudden, now there are rules against carrying guns. You know, this is the West, right? Can you imagine? Yeah, well, I mean, the NRA didn't say anything, but you got the wrong people carrying guns. And so what happens is the Panthers decide they're going to go and protest the passage of this new bill. It's going to be, the Mulford bill is going to be called the Mulford Act. And what they do is go up to Sacramento to view the discussion over this bill. And it's actually a room very much like this. You can't, most of you can't see that door, but what happens is they all, it's about 30 of them, they all get in their cars, leave Oakland, drive up to Sacramento. And the law said that you actually can't have loaded weapons inside your car. So they get to the state capitol in Sacramento and they get out of their cars and then they load their weapons. And so just imagine all these black people in black dress getting out of the car in front of the state house, loading their weapons. And right there to the side was Governor Ronald Reagan. He's talking to a group of 4-H students. He sees these black people get out of the car and load their weapons. He takes off. Leaves the kids to fend for themselves. And we know all of this happens because it's all on videotape. The person who's videotaping Ronald Reagan actually starts videotaping the Panthers because Reagan is now gone. And so they hang out with the kids for a while, but then they wind up inside the state capitol. Of course, none of them have ever been to Sacramento, much less inside the capitol. And so they're immediately lost. And I mentioned the thing about this door here because they asked somebody, where's the viewing room? The viewing room is just like a gallery, like where you all are sitting out here today. And a reporter told them it's right there through that door. And they went through the door. And rather than that being the gallery, that was the assembly floor. So just imagine yourselves as lawmakers and all these black people, men and women, showing up on the assembly floor with a bunch of weapons. It probably wasn't fun. If you haven't seen my book, I encourage you to read at least one page. If you don't read the one page, read the one line. I wrote a book called Up Against the Wall, and the first line of that book, and I'm not going to say it because there are little people in the room. But the first line of that book is, who in the world are these Negroes with these guns? But he didn't say Negroes. He said something else. And of course, the person who said that took off. He didn't wait for an answer because there were Negroes with guns on the floor. But what happens is all of this gets recorded. And Bobby Seale reads executive mandate number one. He's saying, you know, Vietnam is going on, and things are going on in the South, and things are going on in New York and Boston. All this activity is unfolding here, and it's mostly black people being brutalized, black people being murdered because they want to vote, because they want to integrate a school, because their house is nicer. There are actually laws on the books in Alabama, Mississippi, and Georgia that says you can't have a nicer house. I'm not exaggerating. You can go look this up, your students. There's a law in Mississippi that said that you can't pass a white person on the highway. So if a white person's driving 15 and a 25, you just gotta wait. You can't go around them because it's illegal. Yes?
Is that standard to this day?
No. That was 1927. Yeah, I pass them all the time. Yeah, they can't catch me. But that was a good question. But what this does is goes throughout the state of California, then across the country. And overnight, this tiny organization goes from a handful of people, 25, 30 people, to thousands. People in New York, people in New Orleans, people in Boston, people in Wisconsin, people in Illinois say, I want to be a part of that organization. Because keep in mind now, this is May 1967. The Civil Rights Movement has been on the TV every night since Kennedy was elected in 1960. And most of what you see is people saying, there's no way we're going to win our rights, our human and civil rights, without using nonviolence. So you got people watching these news shows going, I want to help, but I ain't gonna let nobody spit on me or hit me in the head with a brick or push me and not push them back, right? And so you really had to be a very strong, courageous, disciplined human being to be involved in the nonviolent civil rights movement. Some people think that's a weak way to do that, but actually, I mean, how much courage does it take to be just strapped down with guns and then go into some crazy community, right? Like Cicero, if you're in Chicago. Or go in there barehanded, where they have all the bricks and the bottles and the Molotov cocktail. I mean, you're not a weak person for being a nonviolent civil rights activist. I can tell you that for sure. I've interviewed a lot of them. But in any case, this gave people an option. The folks who wanted to be a part of the movement now had something they can become a part of because they didn't feel like they were disciplined enough to turn the other cheek. They felt like if you turn the other cheek, you'll get it handed to you. And so when they saw the Black Panther Party on the news, they decided, well, let's go and take care of this. And there are a lot of myths about the Black Panther Party. There's a bunch of black men, like in this image, and all they want to do is go around and kill white people. They're racist, and they're looking to undo civilization, and they're going to do that by just shooting up the whole place and taking it over. Actually, nothing could be further from the truth. The fact of the matter is, by the time the organization was 3 years old, the majority of the people in the party were not men, they were women. by 1972, by the time the organization is 5 years old, the majority of the leadership is women. So it's not just a bunch of black men looking to kill white people. In fact, it was a bunch of black people looking to serve humanity. First, the black community, but humanity in general. The fact that the Black Panther Party remained as small as it did can be explained by them being anti-racist. Remember, I talked just a little bit about the Black Power movement. This was the big Afro time, the natural, you know, black is beautiful, black this and black that, and black people, for the most part, didn't want to have a lot to do with white people. The Panthers were like, that's actually not the best route to take. It's not white people. It's monopoly capitalism. That's the problem. A lot of people in the black community did not necessarily understand that. And so they were like, if you're going to be working with those white folks, and the Panthers were working with white folks, then I don't want to be a part of it. That's why the organization remained as small as it did. It had a bunch of signature programs. One of these programs was the breakfast program. What they learned is that students were not learning in school. And they found out students were not learning in school because they were hungry. And so they decided they would feed the children. The minute they did that, the minute these kids go to school, their grades skyrocket. It's really hard to figure out the square root of something if you're hungry, right? And if you had English professors like me, you're gonna diagram a sentence, but you hadn't eaten since yesterday. I mean, you wanna do it, but you're thinking, what am I gonna eat? Well, the Panthers work to solve this problem, and I bring it up at this point because what they do is go around to the major grocery stores and ask them for food and donations. So if you had milk or juice or eggs or bacon or cereal or money. And you can imagine in the 1960s, the big grocery stores were owned by white people, right? And overwhelmingly, white people was like, okay, here you go. We'll give it to you. So if they were racist, anti-white, not to kill white folks, I doubt these grocers would have given them all the money to serve free breakfasts across the country to something like 20 to 25,000 people every day, right? This program was so successful that the FBI decided it was going to take it over. And by the time I'm a first grader, the federal government has its own free breakfast program, right? To keep people from going to the Black Panther Party's breakfast program, because not only do you get cereal and eggs and bacon, you got a little political education. Like, you got a little black history. There's a little lesson. You might sing a song, you know. And you don't want to raise people from that age because you get somebody that's, you know, 7 or 8 and then they got 10 years of that. Probably going to be a different kind of student when they get to college. So it's best to give them your own breakfast. And so I will admit, a lot of days I went to school to eat because we didn't have food. I knew I was going to get that free breakfast. I knew I was going to get that free lunch, but I got it because they were trying to keep people from going to the Black Panther Party programs. Another signature program were their free health clinics. Of course, the black community had major health issues. I mean, they're poor, they're destitute, they're poverty stricken. They live in homes that have lead in them, holes in the roof, rats and roaches and all other kinds of vermin that might make a person sick. Well, the Panthers realized that they couldn't pay for medical care. And so they brought them medical care. Well, the Panthers aren't doctors. Where would they get that from? Well, they went down to the local university. They found medical students. They found nurses. They found doctors and asked them, would you come to the black community and help us deal with some of these problems? Overwhelmingly, they said yes. Again, 2019, the overwhelming number of people in the nursing field, in the medical field, are white. And these people are funding and supplying the Black Panther Party free health clinics across the country. And so this idea that they are anti-white and racist, I just doubt that doctors and nurses and medical students would be okay with giving their time, their services to an entity that was out to kill them. I just doubt that. So by 1968, the Panthers are on an upsurge. And what we begin to see is they start to feel the heat from the federal government. The federal government start kicking in the doors of these programs, these breakfast programs, destroying the food, burning the cereal, taking the supplies, getting rid of the medical equipment because they don't want to see them succeed. And most people are like, man, those Panthers, they're bad news. I'm not gonna be dealing with that. You know, maybe I need to go and join up with Martin Luther King, because by this time he's getting a little bit more radical too. You know, in 67 he gives that speech on Vietnam. He's going, you know what, I've been thinking. Maybe I could look at it a different way. Well, almost 1 year to the day after he started thinking differently, what happens to King? Like, no, you start talking about this economic stuff, you start saying that we're the greatest purveyor of violence on earth, then it's time for you to go. And that's what he did. He went. On April 4th, 1968, King is murdered in Memphis. And what this does to the Black Panther Party is quadruple its membership, because people are now saying, man, I was going to go with the radical King, but now King is dead. So who do I go with? Well, they begin to go in droves in the Black Panther Party after the murder of Martin Luther King. And these breakfast programs get new life. These free health clinics get new life. They have free clothing, free shoes, free dental. I mean, they have, at the end of the day, about 46 different free social service programs. And how do young, Black, poor people do this, and the federal government that's got trillions of dollars cannot? That's gonna be on the test. Think about that. So once they get this second breath of fresh air, what we start to see is the FBI starts to tighten the screws. And what they want to do is to make sure that the organization doesn't go any further than it's already gone. And so what it does is to come up with something called the Counterintelligence Program. Now, the fact of the matter is the Counterintelligence Program was invented in 1956 to address what was then known as the communist threat. It was retooled in the mid-60s to deal with Black civil rights organizations like King's SCLC, like the NAACP, like the, of all organizations, the Congress of Racial Equality, the Urban League, all attacked and spied on by the FBI. But they really wanted to make sure that the Black Panther Party didn't grow and get other people interested. And so you can see here on the screen the kinds of things that they were trying to prevent the party from doing. I want to point you to the second check mark, that second bullet point, prevent the rise of a messiah. I just want you to know that this is not always an individual. The federal government also saw a messiah as organizations. So it wasn't just Martin Luther King or an A. Philip Randolph or a Huey Newton. It could be the NAACP if they got radical enough. It could be CORE if they got radical enough. It could be the Black Panther Party if it got radical enough. And so, I mean, how do you prevent the rise of an organization like that? You take them to court, you know? What do you do? They don't want the long-range growth. Look at that last one. They don't want the long-range growth of militant Black nationalist organizations. And so they're going to do what they can to stop this organization. And what Hoover does in 1969 is label the organization as the greatest threat to the internal security of the United States. This labeling turned out to be the excuse sheriffs and their deputies, police officers, and other law enforcement officials across the country. That's the excuse they needed to take off the gloves with the Black Panther Party. The top law enforcement official in the United States has says they're a threat. And what do you do with threats, right? If I stop, you know, doing my thing here and start threatening you, you're gonna get up and leave? Probably not. You're gonna show me what for, right? Like, you're gonna make me make good on those threats. Some of you might be pacifists and get up and leave, but most of you probably won't. So this is what happens. Now that the organization has been called a threat by the White House and the FBI, the gloves are off. And what do I mean by the gloves being off? The person who founded the Black Panther Party chapter in Los Angeles in January of 1969, this guy's name is Alprentice Bunchy Carter. Excuse me. He was a student at UCLA at the time. And by the way, Bobby Seale and Huey Newton were also students when they founded the organization, college students at Merritt College. Bunchy Carter was a student at UCLA. He was in a meeting discussing the founding of Black Studies at UCLA. The meeting turned boisterous, and members of the US organization, the guy sitting next to him is Maulana Ron Karanga, the leader of the US organization. You might know him as the founder of Kwanzaa. Didn't like the person they were choosing, and didn't like him so much that they sent people from the US organization to kill Bunchy Carter. And we know this because those documents have been declassified today. We can read the FBI documents, and they show that they had their hand in this. It's crystal clear. It's black and white. It's not redacted. You can go find this out for yourself. So he's killed, along with John Huggins, at UCLA, on the campus of UCLA, in January of 1969. Again, the gloves are off. Same thing in Chicago. Mark Clark and Fred Hampton. Mark Clark is the defense captain in Peoria, Illinois. Fred Hampton is the Minister of Defense for the Illinois State Chapter, but based there in Chicago. Fred Hampton's 21 years old. He took his NAACP youth group in high school from about 40 members to 400 members. So he was a person well known in Chicago long before he joined the Black Panther Party. He made the party better and not the other way around. He was very good at convincing people that there was injustice in the United States. And not only that, he was very good at convincing people that they needed to address the injustice. And when I say people, I don't mean just the black people on the South Side, or the black people on the West Side, or the two black people on the North Side. I mean everybody who would listen to him. And so you've probably heard that Jesse Jackson created the Rainbow Coalition. Not true. It was Fred Hampton who brought together Latinx people. It was Fred Hampton who brought together Native American people. It was Fred Hampton who brought together poor white people, Puerto Rican people. A number of different ethnicities come together in Chicago to address the issues that are plaguing the black community, the white community, the Latino community, and so on and so forth. But the screws are being tightened. So on December 4th, 1969, the FBI authorizes this raid on Fred Hampton's apartment, and he's been drugged by a guy named William O'Neill. The FBI infiltrated William O'Neill into the organization. William O'Neill poured psilocybin into Fred Hampton's Kool-Aid. And based on the coroner's report that I've read, it's enough to kill an elephant. So at about 4 o'clock in the morning on December 4th, the police knock on Fred Hampton's door. Mark Clark answers the door, says, "Who is it?" And they say, "Tommy." He says, "Tommy who?" And they say, "Tommy Gunn." And they start spraying that apartment. They shoot Mark Clark directly through the heart. He's the first person to die. The only shot that the Panthers get off during this particular episode is a shot that Mark Clark lets off in his dying breath. He shoots the shotgun he's holding through the ceiling. The other 101 shots are all from police officers. And there are 8 people in that apartment that get shot up, including Harold Bell. Fred Hampton is in the bed while all of this is going on. Just imagine your bedroom being shot up 100 times, and you don't know it because you've been drugged. Well, his fiance, who was 8 months pregnant, knew it. She was yelling and screaming, saying, you know, there are people in here, there's a baby in here, women in here. They didn't care, they just kept shooting. They corralled everybody into the kitchen, and they went back into Fred Hampton's bedroom, and we know that this dialogue took place because we can read the trial transcripts and see what the police said and see what the other people who were testifying said, and what they said is they heard them say, that's Fred Hampton, is he dead yet? And the other police officer, Carmody was his name, said, I don't know, let's check. And the next thing they heard were two shots from a 45 automatic pistol to the back of Fred Hampton's head. And they heard the guy say, he's good and dead now. And in fact, he was. They drug him out. And there's the end of Fred Hampton. And eventually, the Black Panther Party in Chicago is going to limp along for several years. But nobody was able to replace the kind of dynamism and magnetism and organizational ability that Fred Hampton had. They didn't come in there to arrest him. He wasn't accused of anything. They don't even make up like he had stole something or, you know, spit on the sidewalk. They just went in and killed him. So the Panthers start to go, wait a minute, you know, you're killing all of our people. There are also just thousands and thousands of arrests across the country. The Panthers have this newspaper. People stand out on the street and sell it for a quarter. Individual keeps a dime, the party gets 15 cents. That's how people make money. It doesn't sound like much to you, but in 1968, I mean, I don't want to say too much about my age, but when I was a kid, a Coke cost 10 cents. Can you believe that? You think you can get a Coca-Cola today for 10 cents? No, no, you cannot. A bag of potato chips when I was a kid was 15 cents. I was in 7-Eleven the other night. Why is a bag of potato chips, it's not even good for you. Anyway, they're saying, wait a minute, we need to do something about the situation. You can see how happy the cops are after they killed Fred Hampton. So the Panthers decide they need to do better about defending themselves. After all, their original name was the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. And so they started to fortify their offices as a result, putting up sandbags, putting chicken wire in the windows in case somebody tried to throw tear gas inside. And so they're just going around the country, the police and the FBI, going around the country looking for Panther leaders to kill. Those they can't incarcerate, they want to kill. So they show up 4 days after the murder of Fred Hampton in Los Angeles. All of us have heard of SWAT. Right? Special weapons and tactics. Well, there was no SWAT before the Black Panther Party. The Los Angeles Police Department realized that it was going to be difficult to deal with the party. So they needed a special unit to do this dealing. And they decided to test SWAT out on December 8th, 1969. And that's what they do. They show up at 41st and Central, Black Panther Party headquarters. And they don't even knock this time. They just kick the door open. But here's what happens. It's 4 a.m. The Panthers have a 15-year-old kid on the roof as security, right? And this kid hears dogs barking. It's 4 a.m. What in the world are all these dogs? I mean, there's dogs barking all over the neighborhood. And so that kind of wakes him up. He starts to look around. First thing he sees are people in these black suits crawling up on the roof to where he is. And he got the opportunity. Like, all he needed was a couple of seconds. The sign was to stomp on the roof if something was happening, right? And he was able to do that before they grabbed him, threw him on his head, and injured his neck. Till this day, his neck is not right. But the people heard him stomp on the roof, and they all woke up. And so when the SWAT team rushed through the door with their Tommy guns, automatic weapons, not semi-automatic, we're talking fully automatic weapons that people are using in Vietnam, they're spraying the place. Well, Gil, the 15-year-old on the roof, has given the signal. And Mevin Cotton Smith heard the signal. Well, some kind of way, he had a machine gun too. And so he starts shooting back at the cops. And we know what the cops said because there was a trial afterwards. And what the cops said was, they're shooting back. They're shooting back. Get out, you know. And that was a big deal because usually they catch you sleeping. Like they caught Fred, right? Or they catch you slipping. like they call Bunchy Carter, and so many others I wasn't able to name for you. But these Panthers shot back, and 4 hours later, they were still shooting back. They actually had reinforced the roof with steel plates, so when the LAPD dropped bombs on the roof, it didn't do anything. Well, at the end of 4 hours, you're in a little apartment in downtown Los Angeles. How many bullets do you have, right, after 4 hours? Even if you got 1,000 rounds, and you've been shooting at the SWAT team and they're shooting back, you're gonna run out. And so there's this discussion about, man, what are we gonna do? And everybody in the apartment is saying, in the office is saying, I'm not surrendering, you know. We've been shooting at the police. And they're gonna do something to us if we try to surrender. And I like this part of the story because there are two women in there and they just say, y'all some wusses. You know, what do you mean you're not gonna say, I'll go out there. It's like, I wouldn't recommend that, you know. She's like, this sister, her name's Samaya Moore. They called her Peaches. She's like, give me that shirt. She takes one of the guy's t-shirts, walks out the door, waves it. And guess what? The police don't do anything because they don't like being shot at either. They're tired of being shot at too. They are relieved that people want to surrender. And what happens after that is the rest of them come out. They're being arrested. It's like, whew, man. If you read the history of SWAT, this is a good story. They wore a badge on their uniform for a long time that said 41st and Central 69 because they remembered, you know, you really need to be ready if you're going to go do that kind of thing, right? But in any case, all these people, something like 12, 13 people wind up being arrested. And guess what happens? They get found not guilty. Why do they get found not guilty? Because the Black Panthers decide they want a jury of their peers. Remember the 10-point program? So the voir dire takes almost a year. And they insist on people knowing about them and their communities. And so they get some Hispanic people on the jury. They get some Asian people on the community. They get two Black people. They're both bankers, but hey, what are you gonna do? They're Black on the jury. And the jury finds them all not guilty because the police admitted to shooting. And guess what? In this country, it's not illegal to defend yourself. So yeah, this guy is the person responsible for the fortification of not just the Los Angeles office, but offices all across the country. His name is Geronimo Pratt. He was also sent to prison for 27 years for something the police know he didn't do. They said that he killed a school teacher in Santa Monica. And they know he didn't kill the school teacher because on the day the school teacher was killed, they had the Black Panther Party headquarters bugged, and Geronimo Pratt was actually in a meeting in Oakland in the Black Panther Party headquarters being recorded and not in Santa Monica killing a school teacher. But because they needed to do whatever they needed to do to get him off the streets, because they came to the realization that he's the one that's helping them to defend themselves, they need to get rid of him. Well, why was he so special? Well, he leaves Louisiana, goes to Vietnam twice, becomes a demolition specialist, winds up in the Dominican Republic. See, you probably you know about Vietnam, but during this particular time period, there are people fighting in Mozambique and Zimbabwe and the Dominican Republic. There are people of color all over the world in the 1950s, 60s, 70s, and into the early 1980s who are fighting for their freedom. Some of them are marching and signing petitions, but some of them are actually out there fighting, shooting, throwing rocks, whatever they have to fight with. And Geronimo Pratt had been in the military and was very well versed in military tactics. And he taught a lot of the Panthers those military tactics. And so he was able to hook up with one of the main figures of the organization and take over what eventually becomes known as the underground wing of the Black Panther Party. So the people serving the breakfast, the people working the health clinics, the people selling the newspapers, the people registering people to vote. That's above ground. Now they're saying the police, by way of the FBI, is looking to kill members of the Black Panther Party. So we can either stand here and be killed, or we can run and hide. We can live to fight another day. And so an underground starts to develop in the organization. That underground becomes known as the Black Liberation Army. Now, Black Liberation Army is also a type of concept. There are scholars, political scientists, historians who insist that the Black Liberation Army has been around since the first slave stepped off the first slave ship. There are instances in the 1520s, as an example, in Georgia, where African people who have been enslaved leave the ship, literally go into the swamps of Georgia, hook up with what becomes known as the Seminole Indians, and push the Spanish out of Georgia. You know about the Spanish in Florida, right? Well, they were in Georgia too, until some people in what some scholars call the early Black Liberation Army decided they were going to fight to push them out. And so while there is this defensive posture because these screws are being tightened, the underground starts to employ an offensive strategy as well. And they don't do it willy-nilly. See, I showed that image of the four little girls because I knew it would resonate with you and I knew that you had seen it before. And I showed that image of Emmett Till because I knew it would resonate with you. I showed that image of Trayvon Martin because I knew you had a sense of what that history was like, even though it's not that long ago. During this particular time, it was commonplace for police officers to kill 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15-year-olds in the Black community, and nothing happens. So in this one particular case, we get two police officers who throw a child, a 14-year-old, off the top of a 60-story building because they think he's stolen something. Catch him on top of the building, throw him off. Now you know you're not gonna land on your feet if somebody throws you off a 60-story building, right? Kill him. Now, even if he did steal something, which we don't know, he's dead, right? He didn't get a chance to go to court. The penalty after you're convicted of stealing is not death, right? It's not even jail, depending on where you go to court. It's you pay for what you stole, or probation, or I don't know. You know, I never got caught stealing. You know. But it's not, you don't get killed for it, right? Well, like I said, it's not willy-nilly. So they find the people who are involved in these types of dastardly acts, and they go and have a little payback. And here's an example where you see two members of the New York Police Department who have been involved in the kind of action I'm talking about that then have to answer to the Black Liberation Army. In their view, they're at war. In their view, they're defending the Black community. In their view, they're defending themselves from what they know is coming. Fred Hampton was asleep, remember? Again, not accused of anything. Nobody even insinuated he had done anything. So it's not like you have to have done anything to be killed. You just gotta be. So they decided they were going to start assassinating police officers, and that's exactly what they did. Another example, they say that members of the Black Liberation Army called the police, and they knew what police were coming because these police were going through the Black community causing all kinds of havoc. And so sure enough, they get sent on this domestic battery call, and at the domestic battery call, they walk back to their cars, and people walk up behind them and kill them. That's in 1971. Now, I know you're thinking that's bad. That's horrible. How can they possibly do something like that? Right? I know that's what you're thinking. That's not a good thing. Come on, these are first responders. These are the people who protect us. I mean, I know if somebody breaks into my house, I'm gonna call the police, right? These are people that help us. Like, why are you doing that? Well, unless you lived through this particular period and you saw your brother, your son, your cousin, your neighbor be thrown off a building for no reason, it doesn't make sense to you, right? Unless you're the mother of Emmett Till, who you know didn't do what they said he did, then it won't make a lot of sense to you. Unless you have lived in the kind of situation that prevents you from working, that prevents you from being healthy, that prevents you from having a home that is adequate, you know, that won't make you sick, then it's gonna be very difficult for you to understand how something as extreme, and I admit it's quite extreme, as this can be okay to the men and women in what's called the Black Liberation Army. But we all think of Hamilton and Washington and Thomas Paine, the great patriots, you know, who fought their revolution against the British. They killed a bunch of British people, right? And I'm sure the British thought that that was not good. But how many of us think that that was not good? We think that was fine, don't we? They needed to get out of here. They were taxing us without representing us. We all want to pay those taxes and not get nothing from it. Who wants to do that? Well, that's a good idea to kill people if they do something like that to you. And that's what the American patriots decided they were going to do. And if we look at the French Revolution, don't we hold that up as something that's good? The storming of the Bastille? Do we not do that? All kinds of movies about the French Revolution. Look at the Chinese Revolution. Yeah, it was great, the Cultural Revolution that went on. Well, these individuals thought that they were part of a revolution too. They thought that they were defending their community and their lives too. And this is the type of work they did. So how did they maintain secrecy? Well, they had a bunch of white friends. And as a matter of fact, some of their white friends live right up the road. If you want to get out of sight in the 1960s and 70s, one of the places you could go is Footbridge Farm, not far from Eugene, Oregon. Because there are a bunch of white people that are just cool with them. They understand that you need to do what you have to do, and we'll feed and clothe and supply and hide you. And again, it's why the organization is so small to begin with, because you have a lot of black people who don't see why you want to go and make an alliance with some white folks. You know, they don't. Well, actually, you don't really understand human nature if you believe that. If you sit down and talk to people, you'll find that you have far more in common than you have that's different. Like, if you just base it on this, you're never going to get anywhere. On skin tone, you're never going to get anywhere. All you got to do is look at the black community, right? They're light-skinned people, they get all the props. People like me, I mean, was people like me. So you see what I'm saying? If you just base it off skin color, you're going to be spinning your wheels for centuries. But if you base it off principle, what you'll find is the overwhelming majority of human beings are not the way you think they are, no matter what color they are. Now, that's not to say that whites in general don't benefit from racism, don't benefit more than most people from capitalism. At the end of the day, it's not their fault. They didn't decide who they were going to be born to, just like you didn't decide it. All right? And so we have to get out of our seats, walk across the aisle, talk to people, find out what's going on. If we want to solve a problem, work with folks who want to solve that problem, not with folks that only look like you. Because I can tell you a lot of people that look like me, I don't want to work with, and some of them I'm kin to, right? No, I do. I've got some brothers that you know, you remember that thing about letting people out of jail? I know some people need to be in jail, you know, and I don't want them doing anything for me or with me. So in any case, this situation became really problematic because the FBI didn't know what to do. The Panthers had money, they had places to go, and they had the backing, not just of people like me, you know, in the low, low middle class, but really rich white people. J. Edgar Hoover called them credit card revolutionaries, right? They were getting them false ID, they were sending them to Europe and Asia, they were buying them houses and cars and guns and everything, and they were out there shooting with them. And so I think I'm getting down to the time where I need to stop, so I'm gonna wrap this up. But I'll give you just one example of these black and white people working together and folks trying to show that if you just fight back, people will back off you. And this incident takes place in 1971 in San Francisco, where again, police officers have been running roughshod over the black community, particularly down in the Fillmore and in the Hunters Point Bayview area. They've killed numerous children, 12-year-old, 13-year-old, 15-year-old, all justifiable. And so somebody decides they're gonna respond to that. And they go down to the local police station. Well, they pile into these cars. They go down to the police station. They sneak through the woods. And they're getting ready to do something bold. But they got to wait for the signal. And the signal is the bombing of the Bank of America. So at about 9:20 on this night, the Stonestown branch of the Bank of America is bombed. That almost empties the Ingleside police station because, of course, you know, building's been bombed. It's not just any building. It's the Bank of America. We need to go check it out, right? And some white people bombed that building, all right? Some really rich white people bombed that building. And then you had people who went up into the Ingleside police station and started shooting. Now, luckily, unfortunately, the individuals who stayed behind were behind this doubly reinforced steel door that these people couldn't shoot through. And when they realized they couldn't shoot through it, they stuck a shotgun through the speaking hole where people did business. You know, you pay your ticket or, you know, maybe you buy a license tag or something. I don't know what you buy at the police station, but you can get all kinds of stuff at the police station. They stuck a gun through that hole and pulled the trigger. And that killed Sergeant John Young. And there's the Ingleside police station. They leave Ingleside. You can see the diagram there that the police have put together. And they disappear. That's the end of it. John Young is no more. And the very next day, they decide they're gonna send the San Francisco Chronicle, the local newspaper, a letter. And that letter says, "Message to black people. On the night of August 29th, 1971, revolutionary violence was committed against the Ingleside pigsty as one political consequence for the recent intolerable political assassination of Comrade George Jackson in particular, and the inhumane torture of inmates and prisoners of war camps in general." Panthers were being sent to jail and tortured is what they're referring to. "We retaliate against these acts along with the constant murder and brutality of black people in their communities. We must not forget nor allow our oppressors to continue brutalizing our families and friends of our incarcerated comrades," signed by the George L. Jackson Assault Squad of the Black Liberation Army. So in case you were wondering who did this, we did it, is what they're saying. And the police actually are going to wind up spending about 4 decades and several million dollars looking for the people who did this. They never found them. But what they did do was hire their own security guards. Can you imagine that? The police hired security guards. because the police are really not trained and equipped in 1971 to deal with the kind of threat they're facing. Today, I would not recommend that for you. They're very trained, they're very equipped. Let's sign a petition. Let's take some Black Studies classes. You know, let's do something different. Right? I don't think that's gonna work. It's probably not a good idea. But in 1971, they felt like it was enough to make them see, this is what you're doing to us. This is the extent that you've pushed us through. Like, is it worth all of that? They are basically saying, if there's gonna be crying and wailing in the Black household, there's gonna be some crying and wailing in the White household. Now, for you Christians, you've heard of the I-49, the 242, right? That makes sense to you. But I like what Gandhi and King said. If we go by that, all of us are gonna be blind and toothless. I appreciate his analysis of that, right? So, a few days later in Los Angeles, the police think they've found the people who committed this atrocity. And they follow these people around the streets of Los Angeles, and they eventually get them to pull over. And when they pull over, a thing like this happens. And I got this from the trial transcripts as well. One police officer, actually a guy named Officer Kapelkoff, gets out of the police car, walks up to the back of the car, and points his pistol inside the back seat. It says, put your hand on the seat. Put your hands on the seat. And he's saying a lot of other words that I don't want to say because the, you know, young people are in here. But it's MFs, a lot of that is going on. And the guy he's talking to sees him, you know, he just said he felt like the guy was gonna shoot him, and sure enough, he shoots him. And when he shoots him, this guy shoots back. And when he shoots back, there's this shootout. There are 200 bullet holes in the car they were riding in. But the guy on the back seat, the guy driving, and the guy in the front seat decided they're gonna shoot back. And they shot back until they ran out of bullets. I mean, you're in a car, you probably got a pistol, but the police has got a whole bunch of weapons. And the guy that, you know, he told to put his hands up on the seats winds up getting shot 6 times, twice in the head. They are arrested at 9/11 of all times that night. They make it to the hospital at 11:37, trying to ride around, let them bleed to death, right? But they don't bleed to death. And in fact, they take them to jail, and they wind up bailing out of jail. How do they bail out of jail? They've got about a $75,000 bail between the three of them. They're poor people. Members of this organization took a vow of poverty. Well, the way they funded their activities was through what they call expropriations. Me and you might call it bank robbery. So they rob bank after 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 bank. After bank, and I keep saying that because they robbed a bunch of banks in a bunch of cities throughout the United States. That's how they funded themselves. I mean, you can't imagine you're gonna go to work and make your $2.15 an hour at this point and fund the revolution, right? They decided they were gonna go get money from where people kept money, keep money in banks. And they did not get caught. Here is the windup to this. Just about done here. A person associated with individuals in that car was arrested in New Orleans. It's late on July 3rd. The 4th of July is coming up, and he's been partying. Reuben Scott is from San Francisco, but he's in New Orleans. He's a member of the Black Liberation Army. And he's got to pee. He goes to this gas station and asks the proprietor, can he use the bathroom? Well, it's 1973, and you might or might not be able to use the bathroom in the South in 1973. And in this case, the answer was no. You can't use the bathroom. So he says, all right, fine. He went around the building and peed on the grass. You know those big, shiny mirror objects some stores have? Like if they don't want to spend the money on a camera, you can look at the mirror and see around the corner. Well, the guy looks up. There's a dude peeing. He calls the police. The police come. There's a tussle. They wind up breaking this guy's arm, arresting him, but then letting him go, charging with, you know, indecent exposure. Well, 3 days later, they find out he's not who he said he was. He said he was Joe somebody, but he's actually Reuben Scott. Well, it's 1973. Like me and you, we get pulled over today. They're going to know everything about you in the first 30 seconds. Well, about me, maybe not you. Well, the first 30 seconds, they go, oh, yeah, it's that guy, you know. Well, it took a little bit of time in 1973 to get to the bottom of somebody's identity. And so they realized this is Reuben Scott. He's wanted for bank robbery in San Francisco. Like, they're robbing these banks. They're so good at it, they don't even have masks on, right? I said, oh, you see the pictures? And somebody said, that's Reuben. I'm like, all right, so now we're looking for Reuben. He goes to San Francisco, stays a week or two, comes back to New Orleans, and they start following him. And they eventually find him, pick him up, arrest him, and they start torturing him and asking him, where are your friends? We know y'all been running around the country robbing these banks, shooting at the police, killing the police. Where are your friends? They do all kinds of dastardly stuff to him. And he tells them where his friends are. And they go and arrest his friends. And these friends are also tortured. And I want to play, if you'll indulge me, I want to play a brief clip for you of the description of this torture. And I will wind up after that.
They came out with a plastic bag, put it over my head. And they started beating me with the bag over my head. About time I was about to lose consciousness, about to pass out, they'd snatch the bag off. And while I'm trying to catch my breath, they would start beating me again. So I asked them, I said, well, what do you want? You know, and they just continued on with it. They didn't ask me any more questions. They didn't ask any questions, really.
Two of the detectives who came from San Francisco were named Frank McCoy and Ed Ertelatz. They had been investigating a police homicide that had occurred in 1971.
Then they came out with this cattle prod. I knew what it was because being off of a farm when I was a kid, my family used to go to Louisiana every year to work the little family farm. And my uncles, we had some cows, and they used cattle prods to move those cows up chutes and stuff like that. So I seen that and I knew what it was.
The cattle prod was placed on my genitals, placed in my asshole, placed under my feet, placed under my arms.
Down in my private parts, under my neck, behind my ears, down my back. I think I passed out one time. They woke me back up, and they was taking me to another room. Two detectives had me by one arm, by each arm, and a detective came out of nowhere, and he just cold-cocked me and he knocked me straight out. I was unconscious.
Another instrument that was used during the questioning was a ledger logbook, and this ledger logbook was used to hit me upside my head at times when I was not giving the right answers that was script for me.
They took me into a holding cell. They threw water on me. I was soaking wet. It was cold. Pulled me out of there maybe about 6 or 7 in the morning and told me they had somebody they wanted me to talk to. I'd better cooperate, and if I didn't, I was going to get more of the same. So they put me in there. It was two detectives from San Francisco. I later found out it was McCoy and Ertelax. They started asking me questions, and they told me they had a script, I'm sure I saw a recorder there too. And they was reading to me about what they said took place in San Francisco. I told them I had no knowledge of it.
When I did not answer the questions in the way that they wanted them to be answered, this is when the instruments that I named before would be used, primarily by the New Orleans Police Department. They were the main physical aggressors. The FBI and the San Francisco Police and the Los Angeles Police and the New York Police were the ones to do the questioning after the physical abuse had taken place from the New Orleans Police Department.
Torture has an ugly connection with United States history, at least dating back to slavery. The lynching of slaves who ran away, the castration, the mutilation of slaves was all used in this country and not sanctioned for hundreds of years. In the 60s and 70s, particularly against the Black Panther Party, beatings and interrogation, forms of torture were being used against members of the Black Panther Party primarily. And what happened in 1973 in New Orleans is one example.
All during the time this was taking place, I can hear John Bowman in another room where he was hollering, and you could hear the licks being passed. They took what they call a slap jacket. It's like a little short black jacket. And they started working the back of my neck, my shoulders. Then one would get down and he'd work my shins and between my knees. They would beat me like that. They did that, I don't know, it seemed like it was hours, but it could have been 30 minutes, could have been an hour, could have been 2 hours, I don't know. It's back again with the plastic bag. This time they had a blanket. I don't know what they soaked it in, but it was really, really hot. And they just covered me with that blanket and put that plastic bag over my head. And I couldn't scream, I couldn't holler, I couldn't get my hands up to poke a hole in the bag because I was handcuffed to the chair and my legs were tied to the chair. And they kicked the chair over and let me just suffocate. I was just about to pass out. They'd snatch it off, spit in my face. They left me sitting there for a little while. McCoy and Erdelax, they started asking me questions. And I had no knowledge of the things they were asking me, so I couldn't answer them, you know. So they said, well, they turn off the recorder and whatever they had and said, well, we'll tell you what happened. And then after we tell you, this is what we want you to say.
So I did make statements. I did waive my rights to an attorney, which means I waived my Miranda rights. I did all of this because of the physical aggression and the brutality that was being put upon my body.
One got behind me and he took his hands and he slapped them like that over my ears. I couldn't hear nothing. My ears were just ringing so bad. I could feel fluid running down my side of my face. And they were talking to me, but I couldn't hear them. All I could hear was ringing. Whenever they stood me up to make me walk, I couldn't walk. They had to just kind of just carry me back into the other room. And when they get me back in there, they start again. They would kind of grin and laugh. They were all laughing. They thought it was a lot of fun. And I was a big joke. They started asking me questions. So I started talking to them. I followed their whole script. Everything they told me to say, I said it just like whatever Ruben told them, I repeated what Ruben said. So they said, well, we got what we want. And we're through. Federal magistrate in New Orleans ordered me out of the custody of New Orleans Police Department. That's the only way I got away from him.
So yeah, they then are taken to the county jail rather than the police jail there in New Orleans, and eventually they're extradited back to California to stand trial for the shootout in that car that I showed you to earlier. But the point I wanted to make here is that you probably read in the news a couple months ago about all the torture that happened in Illinois, where there was just case after case after case over a 30-year period of people being tortured and sent to prison, and none of them had done what they were accused of doing, because pain will make you do things that you wouldn't ordinarily do, which is why torture is not an effective tool to do that. I mean, if I was just telling you, don't commit crimes with me, because if they say I'm gonna put an electric cattle prod somewhere, I'm just gonna be like, he it was him. You know, it was his idea. He made me come with him. It's pain is something that we think, you know, because we read about it and watch it on TV, we can endure. But the kinds of, you know, thousands of volts of electricity going into places that you can't imagine will make you say whatever anybody wants you to say. So they get extradited back to California. They stand trial for this shootout. Remember I told you where the police officer started shooting and they shot back? Well, they too had a jury of their peers. They were found not guilty. And as soon as they were found not guilty of that shootout case with the LAPD, the San Francisco court system decided they were going to try to prosecute based on what they learned from the torture. And the judge just asked them, you know, where'd you get this information from? This will take just a second. And it was like, well, they confessed to it. It's like, okay, confess to it. Well, Reuben Scott's lawyer had found the medical records in New Orleans of where he had been sent to the hospital. And so they subpoenaed the doctor who treated him. And they brought him from New Orleans to Los Angeles. The doctor said, yeah, he had been beaten. So they subpoenaed the New Orleans police. The New Orleans police show up in LA, and they're like, what, y'all don't do that? You know, that's how we do it. Like, they didn't even try to deny it. And the judge was like, no, we don't do that. You can't, I mean, you can't use a coerced confession. They threw it out. Tried them again. They threw it out. And so let's fast forward to January 23rd, 2007, 36 years after that crime. The men that they thought were involved, they arrested all across the country, San Francisco, in Los Angeles, New York City, Panama City, Florida, all at 5:30 in the morning. SWAT teams, sheriff's department, police department, Homeland Security, you name it. Some of these men are in their late 60s, some of them are in their early 70s, and they're saying now, remember back during that day when they were talking about enhanced interrogation? You know, is waterboarding okay? Remember Abu Ghraib, Guantanamo? Yeah, it was all in the news, and people were like, yeah, you know what? They're trying to kill our soldiers, so we should be torturing them. It's okay. Well, they decided to arrest them because they thought the public would go for it. Well, they do arrest them. They hold him on $13 million in bail combined. The New York Times, the Washington Post, the San Francisco Chronicle, the Oakland Tribune write these beautifully worded articles saying, oh, we got this new technology, now we got their DNA, we got their fingerprints, we got an eyewitness. We've got them. This is January 2007. Well, they do DNA swabs on all of them. The DNA doesn't match anybody. They said that they had the weapon that was used to kill the person. Turns out they don't have the weapon. They said they had an eyewitness. Turns out they didn't have an eyewitness. They said one of them dropped a cigarette lighter and left his fingerprint on the cigarette lighter at the scene. Turns out the fingerprint didn't fit anybody they had arrested. So I've held you long enough, but I'll tell you that $10 million and 4 years later, the California Superior Court dismissed the charges with prejudice because there was no evidence against the people that they had arrested. And there was a nationwide movement to free the San Francisco Eight. And so you had a bunch of people, as a matter of fact, here in Oregon and Washington and California and New York, all over the country, who thought that this was a travesty. And they stood up and they allowed these people to come to their universities and speak about the issues that they were dealing with. And again, after 4 years, they were acquitted. And that's a picture of them on the steps of 850 Bryant Street, the county courthouse in San Francisco, after they had been acquitted. Now, two of them aren't in that picture because two of them were arrested in their prison cells in New York State. Jaleel Muntakin, who used to be Anthony Bottoms, and Herman Bell had been in prison since the 1970s for two of those police killings that I showed you about earlier. Herman Bell was released last year after pleading nolo contendere, or no contest, to this crime. And you know what his penalty was? Nothing. Time served, no probation. Now, they just wanted somebody to say that I was there. Well, Herman Bell said, all right, I was there. He's walking the streets of New York now because there was absolutely no evidence whatsoever that he, in fact, was there. That was the only way. At the end of the day, I'll open it up for question and answer now, but at the end of the day, he's been in jail for 44 years. He actually wants to go home. It's cold in the San Francisco jail. They have him on the crazy floor where there's yelling and screaming all day and all night. And the food is horrible. So he's like, I'm in prison anyway, right? The county jail in San Francisco is horrible. Attica is great, you know, send me back to Attica. And of course, they actually do that. But the last point I wanted to make is that without people coming out, students, old people, young people, Native American people, Latinx people, white people, a bunch of white people coming out and supporting these individuals, they would not have survived. Remember I told you about the $13 million? Wealthy white people all across the country and in California put up their houses to pay their bills. And they did that because they were sure these individuals had nothing to do with that crime and they weren't going to run off to some country where there's no extradition treaty. And so the only point I'm trying to make there is that let's not focus on the color of the thing. Let's focus on the principle of the matter. And when we do that, what we'll find is that as people, we can wield our own power. And so I'll leave you with that. That's power to the people. Thank you very much.
Wow. Let's give him another round of applause, please. Dr. Kurtz Austin.
Thank you. Thank you
very much. In the hood, right across the street at the University of Oregon. So at this time, just briefly because it's getting late, but if you have some questions, now you heard the words that just came out of my mouth, questions. Not comments, and we don't need you to bloviate more than I'm doing right now. So if you have any questions specifically about the talk, please come up at this time. And I'm hoping, you know, the brother's authoring two books coming up, so maybe we could have them back and maybe do a book talk or something like that. I think people will enjoy that. So again, we'll negotiate that. I'm putting them on the spot right now.
I'll be happy to come.
We definitely want to promote his work, his scholarship, right? So with that being said, I'm going to turn the mic outward. So if you have any questions, you can just form a line down this way.
So I'm a veteran of the Marine Corps veteran, served Iraq, Afghanistan. I served with every nationality you can possibly imagine. My question is, what is the goal of the BSU as it stands today? Like, what are they trying to achieve are they trying to bring you, like, I didn't know that they were trying to bring back the Black Panther movement. And is it similar to the Black Panther movement of the original ideals?
The BSU, the Black Student Union?
Yes, I guess it's a two-part question. What is the BSU, and also in your speech, you hit a little bit about the new Black Panther movement suing the previous, I guess, administration of Black Panthers. So what is their purpose now?
Well, the Black Student Union, as far as I know, it's different on every campus, but they kind of come together, students come together in the Black Student Union to forward an academic undertaking. I don't think there's a lot going on. There should be. I don't think there's a lot going on with community connections. I don't personally see it myself either at the University of Oregon or anywhere else where I go visit around the country. So that's an answer that will have to come from members of the BSU because I can't really speak for them. But I do know they typically advocate for a Black Studies curriculum. They typically advocate for equality for Black students, but other students as well. They typically advocate for space on campuses to do various and sundry things. So that would be the BSU. And your second question regarding the new Black Panther Party versus the original Black Panther Party is, what are they trying to do?
Yeah.
I don't really know the answer to that. I don't think that they are carbon copy. I haven't seen the new Black Panther Party's programs. I've heard them, in fact, when I've listened to their speeches on things like YouTube, make anti-Semitic remarks, make racist remarks. The Black Panther Party that I study did not do that and is not known for that. So I can't really say what their overall goal is. And I think that's why the traditional, the original Black Panther Party continues to try to sue them, because they're sullying their name. They're making it look like they are anti-white, when the Panthers wouldn't have survived 6 months if they were anti-white. So if we remove the caveat that you can make a statement, would that help? Okay.
Yeah, I'm honored. I'm totally happy that I got to hear you. You know, I'm from Tupelo, Mississippi, by the way.
Oh, Tupelo, right on. I went to Mississippi State. I spent a lot of time in Tupelo.
Thank you for doing this.
All right, thank you for coming. Appreciate that.
Hey, I've been on that crazy floor on San Francisco jail.
Oh.
But anyway.
Okay.
So, well, I just wanted to invite all people of color and everybody who's in any movement, actually, to get into the habit of video recording your events and your important speakers who have something to say. Anytime there's information, anytime there's something that somebody has something to say that we can learn from, because our newspaper has been bought out by national chain, all of our broadcast TV, and those guys are just cranking it out, and they've got millions of viewers, you know. And so we have to develop our voice, keep repeating endlessly, and you know what? We can repeat endlessly. So we can do it. We can win this battle, you know. So anyway, please tell me some of your any people of color who are doing video, and I want to work with them.
Okay.
And, I gave you my card earlier.
Okay. Thank you very much. We appreciate that. Yes, sure.
Have you heard, and, you know, I don't believe everything that's on the internet. Let me just preface it by saying that. But I did hear one of the, I guess he's a researcher of Martin Luther King and the death of Martin Luther King. And he's now coming out saying that, yes, Martin Luther King was definitely gunned down, but he survived to the hospital. And once he got there, he was suffocated by two, probably FBI or CIA members. Have you heard anything about that?
I've probably read the same thing you read. I have heard about that. I don't have any evidence to prove that. I do know that the FBI has been engaged in far worse activity. I would not be shocked to find that that's true, but I don't have any evidence that it's the case. I do know that King was all about love and nonviolence. I do know that. And I'm not exactly sure how that's threatening. So, you know, I think there's a way that if we study hard and read a lot and are vigilant, we can eventually connect the dots, but that's not something I have access to right now. But I remember coming across something similar, and I'm not surprised to hear that, but I wouldn't teach a class and say, hey, this is true. I feel like this is a part of history. I just don't have the evidence for it.
Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. Yes.
So the two photos of where the cops were white and black, both of them. My question is, in your research, have you found that the black cops were accidentally shot, and they were because they were with the white cops by association, and or what do you think it's about internalized racism where the black cops were doing what their white colleagues thought needed to happen, and or was it about self-preservation? And I'm asking because I have members of my family who are cops, and they share their concerns about their colleagues, but also concerns for their safety, because they're like, who's gonna have our back? So I'm saying, like, when you were showing the Black Liberation Movement and or them defending themselves, it was a white cop and a black cop in both of those instances that were killed. And I'm asking if it was perceived as if the black cops in both those situations were complicit or directly linked to violence.
Yes, I think that's a very good question. Thank you for asking. I too have brothers who are police officers. And you can imagine Thanksgiving dinner. So one of the things that police departments around the country started doing after the Watts uprising in 1965, because people in the black community no longer wanted cops in their communities, they start sending in these multicolored teams. They started hiring a lot of black police officers who could ride in the community with their white compatriots. And sometimes they would be guilty of some of the dastardly acts that I described, and sometimes they would be there as a person working his job as a police officer. And perhaps maybe they were not. But at the end of the day, the individuals who are carrying out these kinds of activities were not concerned about an individual's race or ethnicity. The problem was the police were killing people in the black community. And sometimes white police officers did it, and sometimes black police officers did it. In the case of Fred Hampton, who I talked to you about, Gloves Davis is a black police officer. We know today that it was Gloves who pulled the trigger, right? So I don't know if any of you have ever interacted with a black cop, but that being black don't make you a whole lot better cop. I mean, I might be telling on myself, but they're no nicer than anybody else. And that includes my brothers. I have a brother who's a cop in New Orleans, and I don't know if you've heard about the New Orleans Police Department, but you want to drive the speed limit and obey all the rules when you're in New Orleans, because if you run up on him, it's not going to be good. You know, and he's been like that since we were kids, right?
There's diversity in our experience, too.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a very good question, but not every time. But for members of the Black Liberation Army, your race was incidental.
Yeah.
Very good question. I appreciate that. Anyone else?
Okay, so I have a clarifying question first. Am I correct that the FBI, the CIA, and the SWAT were all created in response to Hoover saying that black people were the greatest threat?
No, the FBI and the CIA already existed. SWAT was created in response to the heavily armed nature of members of the Black Liberation Army.
Okay, and so has there been like a public or popularized restructuring of that organization since then to say, well, now we're not just here to fight black people?
It's certainly been restructured. Mm-hmm. But I don't know if you saw the pictures of Ferguson and Baltimore. I mean, what we got from Anderson Cooper and Don Lemon was, look at them burning down that building. Not look at all this other stuff that is happening to them off camera. When everybody, if you're a news person on the ground in Ferguson, you know that the sheriff's department, the police department, the SWAT team are not being nice to people. So yes, they've been restructured not to do that. I don't know. I'm going to say I doubt it.
SWAT team gets called in. I mean, they're pretty nasty to everybody.
It's time to rock and roll, huh?
Look at Ruby Ridge. There's lots of,
So I think right here, I had a question.
Here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
I apologize if this is a question that you're not able to answer. It's kind of a question. Given that the Black Panther Party was able to mobilize so many people so quickly in so many instances, they were really able to ride around, not just the African-American community, but people, like you said, people who were Latinx, people who were Asian, even other white girls, they realized that you're going to need a broad coalition of people uniting against capitalism and everything. My question then is, what in your mind could be done to bring that back?
I think that's a great question. I think we need to start talking to each other and identifying the problems in our communities. You know, the problem in your community might not be the one in mine, but I need to come and help you. And when we're done taking care of your business, you need to come and help me do the same thing. I don't think that we need to continue. We're too intelligent. The 21st century with the internet and everything else shows us that not only is race, you know, contrived in a social construct and just completely made up by, you know, the half of the 1%, but it's really the only thing that's saving capitalism. Like, if white people got over themselves, if black people stop thinking that it's that white person's fault who just called me the N-word, and that's why things are so bad, if we got over ourselves and had a dialogue, had a conversation, all the things we complain about would be gone in a very short amount of time. Because it's built on sand. The system is not built on a solid foundation, right? It's all men are created equal. There's liberty and justice for all. You know that's not true. You know? So I think just some of this, sitting down, working it out, and you're gonna go to jail. You might get killed, but you're hopefully not doing it for you, right? We have to do it for humanity. We have to do it for the world. And you certainly can't do it alone. I mean, the struggle is gonna be protracted, and you have to imagine that you might not succeed before you die. But if you keep doing it, if you look around this planet, you'll see that folks who fought for their freedom are now free. That's not magic, all right? It takes a little work.
So with that being said, I wanna thank you. I'm sorry we get to all the questions, but we have to get out of here. Please fill out the survey. And I just want to acknowledge the BSU for doing a wonderful job. Let's give it up for them.
All right, yeah.
All the work that they've done to put this together. Again, I want to thank Dr. Austin for coming out. Give him another round of applause. And again, thank you all.